I was visiting with Bob shortly after he got the verdict that his days upon this earth were numbered. And we were talking about his home, where he was getting ready to go. He's ready to go. It was just that he knew when he would be going there sooner than what most of us know. And he said, Murray, I'd sure like for you to sing that song, Sweet Beulah Land, a song that talks about the home that I'm going to. You know, the Apostle Paul talked to the Corinthians, and he said, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. And Jesus himself said, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you shall be also. I'm looking forward to that place that he has prepared. I'm kind of homesick for a country to which I'm never been before.
you're a child of God and you've got the Holy Spirit in you, and He can't stop you from serving Him. You be bold for the Lord. Don't ever be afraid. I should like to have that dumped on you. You've been saved 3 days. Yeah, about 3 days. My wife and I were saved and baptized here in this church about 40 years ago. And on that Sunday night following that, we were invited to the Holtz house for a reception of just people coming over there, a fellowship. And that's when Bob Holt took me under his wing. And he became my nurturer for the next year and a half, and almost 2 years that we lived here in Fulton. And I'm telling you, I was baptized with fire with that boy. And he didn't want to hear any excuses. What was so exciting about this thing, I did not know anything. I was a heathen. And I got saved. I didn't know what it meant to get saved. It took a little while. First Sunday, the preacher said, keep saying, coming to Jesus, coming to Jesus. My wife and I didn't know what that meant, so we went home. It was the following Sunday we got saved. And that Sunday night, we went to the Holtz house. Hallelujah. The following Wednesday night, we had prayer and devotion. I really didn't know much about that either. But after that, he comes up to me and he says, how'd you like to go a little visiting with me tonight? My vocabulary grew that night. I didn't know there was a difference in visiting and witnessing. I thought there was a difference. I never knew the term witnessing. But we go to this person's house and we're going to witness to him. So we're sitting out in the car, and he said, before you ever go to witness to someone, you want to make sure you pray. And I said, I thought we'd come to visit somebody. Well, we are going to visit them, but we're going to witness to them too. So he's praying all these things, and I'm in a daze. I'm praying nobody's home. You know, I'm scared to death. I don't know what this guy's doing. He said, okay, now let's go. I said, Bob, I don't think anybody's home. I don't see any lights. Oh, yeah, they're home. We knock out on the door. It's kind of late. So the man comes to the door and he says, it's kind of late, but it's not too late for Bob. He starts talking, and in a few minutes we're inside the house. Now I'm just following the law. And so we're sitting down and he starts a little chat. It's like Jim was saying earlier, a little chit chat. And then he starts to get into it. And it's somebody he knew at work. Well, to come to make a long story short, before we left, he did his best to get this man to pray Jesus in, but he didn't. But you know what? 3 weeks later he did. I think he worked at AP Green. I can't remember what it was. But 3 weeks later he did. So he was, that was the night that he broke me in to witness it. And that's the night that he was really starting to nurture me. And so every Wednesday night, we would go on visitation. I learned about visitation. And in about 6 or 7 weeks, I was getting as excited as he was. I thought, this is exciting. This really is exciting. So this went on and on the time I was here. And I would start underlining in my Bible all the scriptures he was using for witnessing. I had to do that. He said, you've got to study. You've got to memorize them scriptures. You've got to be prepared to give an answer. Because people are going to ask you questions. Like Jeff said, he had tracks. He always had tracks. And so I begin to study. And next thing you know, he calls me up and he says, you know what? Well, actually, the preacher called me up. He talked to Bob. I've been saved 3 weeks. And he says, do you think it's time to start serving the Lord a little bit? And I said, what are you talking? He said, we're going to have you in the ministry. Think you want to get in the ministry? Or what's a ministry? That's when they started the bus ministry. Okay? So we met at Cecil, and a whole group of us went out on Saturday knocking on doors to get kids to ride on the church bus to get them there, because when we get the kids, we give it to parents. So we did this every Saturday. And Sunday, Bob would ride the bus and we'd pick up these kids and bring them here. Okay, so we had the bus ministry going. next thing you know, he's talking about a jail ministry, okay? And so we got involved with Prison Fellowship Ministries on down the line a little bit. Well, I'd been here probably almost 2 years before my company moved me out. And we went to a spiritual desert. But if it hadn't been for the nourishment that he gave me, oh, he nurtured me good. Julie was being nourished, and the ladies were working on her. She would have been nurtured. And so we went into a spiritual desert in St. Genevieve, Missouri. It was about 85% Catholic. And we had a mission field out of this world. And Bob and I would be in contact, of course, and knew the Prison Fellowship Ministries of Jeff City. So the more I got involved, the more I got to study, I ended up in jail also as a chaplain. Excuse me. I got into prison, and I was a chaplain for over 20 years because of his encouragement, pushing it, and God was leading me. But God was leading me, but he was using Bob to steer my steps. And it was the most exciting time of my life when he and I would be doing things and praying together. And this young man, I call him young, because it just blessed my heart. Didn't bless your heart today? Bob says one night, he said, "Now, brother, we need to sit down and pray about something real serious." And I said, "What's that?" He says, "Jeff, I'm really concerned about him, and I just want him to serve the Lord so much and so bad." And I almost said, "Oh, ye of little faith." But I didn't. And so, look what he turned out to be, huh? Fine preacher boy, isn't he? And I'm telling you, God has a way of using people and doing things with people and moving in their lives. And that's what God did in my life through Bob Hope. There was never a dull moment. There was never a time he wouldn't witness to somebody. And he says to me, and I remember that, "You've got to be bold. And if you're not bold, Satan will push you down." And he says, "Whatever you do, you stand up and you be accountable for Jesus Christ." I'll never forget the times we spent together in the Word ourselves. We would pray together. We would study the Bible together. We would do all kinds of things together. And it was an exciting time of my life. And for the last 39, 40 years, it's been like that. Because we got adopted into the Holt's family the night we got saved and went to their house. And they have been closer than any blood relatives to me. And we love them so dearly. And now that Jeff has his family and Sheila has her family, it's the first time I get to see these family members. And I hadn't seen Rich since the day of the wedding. And so that's been a long time, huh, Rich? And so, but praise God, what a beautiful family they do have. So anyway, I just want to tell you that I'm standing here because of the grace of God that got me saved in this church, and I've been able to serve the Lord. I've been through the seminary, got 3 degrees, got ordained, and been in the ministry ever since I left this church. And because God ordered my steps, but Bob Hope steered me in those steps and nurtured me, encouraged me to keep on going and serving the Lord. And that's what I want to do, like Jeff said today. You don't want to ever say no to Jesus. Just jump in line, get excited, say yes to him, and get saved. And from then on, the Holy Spirit will guide you through everything that you're doing. And you'll have the most exciting life that you've ever lived once you come to know Jesus. Until you come to know Jesus, you don't know what life is. But once you know him, it's an exciting time. And it gets better and better all the time. As I get older, it gets better. Some of the faces I got to see this morning, they recognized us a little bit. We recognized them, but we couldn't put a name on every one of them because it's been too long. But praise Jesus for this church, because this is where Julie and I have come to know Jesus. And she, just one quick thing, I know we've been here a long time, but we got involved in another ministry called the Lord's Supper. We didn't know what that meant either. And so we came down on a Saturday, filled all the communion cups, got all the bread together, showed how to do that. We were downstairs, they were getting ready for a wedding. And so we asked the lady, "Well, we don't want to, you're putting your food in there, where should we put the Lord's Supper?" She said, "Well, she put it in that one over there." First time. We didn't know it was a freezer. We didn't know it was a freezer. So Sunday morning, we come down early, we get out, all the juices froze. Oh, yeah, Lord, I was trying to get that cube out of that glass, you know. It was froze, so we brought it up to the communion table, and we laid hands and prayed over it. Let me tell you, Bob Hope says, "Don't worry about it, the Lord will take care of it," you know. And he did. And we shook, it was through Sunday school, but you know what? All but the bottom tray, all that stuff, but you know what? It's like slush. When they drink, it's slush. I bet they're thinking, woo! We got a, what do you call those things? A slushy or a slurpy or whatever it is. But she brought that up this morning. So in our experience, in different ministries, it's always been exciting of what we did in serving the Lord. So anyway, those are a little bit more things that happened with me, with Bob Holt, for the last 39 years. I'd like to open it up now. Does anybody else here have anything else they would like to say? Anything you'd like to come up and say and share that you've had a personal experience with Bob and things that's very, very important in your life with Bob? Anybody at all? Oh, somebody's coming. Okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, take turns and you come right up. Okay. What? The whole church is going to come and say this.
This is Bernie Stukenbor, my brother Martin, and sister-in-law Jane in the back. And this is my good friend Ted Zeigen. We started coming to this church and to Fulton High School somewhere around 1979, 1980. I was in that metal trades class, and Bob was there. And it gave me a profession, and he was so bold in his witness during those days. We'd go out to Bob and Dolores' house, barbecue, people, some of the really bad people in high school came to Christ during those days. And it led to the point where after Tim got saved, we were reading the Bible in the library at the high school because it just emboldened us being part of what Bob was doing, and it really changed things.
Well, Bob Holt and Dolores, Jeff, Stukenborns, what a time. This church, I haven't been back to this church in several years. But Bob Holt was an amazing man. And he touched many. He touched us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. I was one of those students in Mr. Bob's class, senior in high school, and he was not just a good man, he was a great man, and I thank God for that. But as already has been said here, he touched so many people's lives. I'm also a truck driver, and I've seen what he done with the truckers ministry and how he's touched guys' lives that are away from home, having hard times, but I did get the chance to visit Mr. Bob after church a short time ago whenever I found out he was doing bad. So I remember his eyes lit up whenever I opened the room. He remembered me instantly. And I thank God for men like Bob Hope, great man, great Christian. I told his daughter a while ago, Bob Holt was one of those men that little boys wish they could grow up to be, and the kind of guy that other men wish they would be like. Thank God for Bob Holt.
Amen.
Thank you.
Bob was my uncle. His men. I have memories of when I was 15 years old that I'll cherish the rest of my life. Things that I'm sure all of us have uncles and have things that we'll remember. Just the love that he showed me when I was 15 years old when I got to come up here in Missouri and California. California's not all that bad. I just remember, you know, the time he tried to teach me things that, you know, my parents were divorced, you know, so divorce is hard on families and hard on the kids. And fortunately for me, I found a nice Christian woman. I was married for 30 years. But just knowing that, to have an example of how a husband and wife should be when I was growing up. And because of that, you know, it's finding someone that's a Christian that you can share your life with to just make things better for both of you. Things that I'll remember mostly about Uncle Bob is the time he spent with me when I was here. It's too short. His life was too short, and like Jeff was saying, we tend to take things for granted until they're gone from us. Well, what I remember mostly about Uncle Bob is the things that he did for me when I was 15, showing me things that my dad didn't show me, showing me how to help build his log garage. That's one of the things we worked on together. He took the time and took me to the school when he was working at the school, showed me how to do things with machinery. We made a copper ring, I still remember. I just love that guy and I always will.
Anybody else?
2 weeks ago, I got my last hug from him. And he said, "Ray, would you speak a few words of my service?" I said, "Bob, I don't know too much good about you, I could say, so only be a few words." And he said, "No, not about me, about winning souls. I don't want you to talk about me."
Hello, I'm Eugene Allen, very short. On Tuesday mornings at 8:30, we have a prayer group. Murray here is the leader, and Bob has always been there. Allowed me to be part of it. It's called Men of Integrity. And I have to admit, Bob is a man of integrity.
Anybody else? Anybody else? Chicken won't get cold. Never got to be this tall, but I drink the water. Hey,
the Bible says that we are to seek first our Heavenly Father, His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto us. What's your priority in life? Is it yourself? Is it your achievements? Or is it our Heavenly Father, getting to know Him better and serving Him? As we worship Him, He will fulfill His purposes through our lives. Let's stand together and sing the chorus, "Worship His Majesty."
Our service. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you.